Alright, before we start with the optimization tutorial, I just want to repeat what I told you in the topology optimization already, what actually optimization is. Optimization is basically an act, process, or methodology of making something as fully perfect, functional, or effective as possible. The general optimization problem can be defined as this, where f is the objective function. This is usually to be minimized. G are the constraint functions that must be satisfied in an optimization. Both of these functions, the objective function and the constraint functions, are functions of the design variable, and this can have lower and upper bound limits. There are m constraints and n design variables for any optimization problem. Exactly one response must be the objective function, or all other responses can be constraint functions. The classical approach in an optimization is the following. You create and analyze a design, and then in the next step, you interpret the results of your analysis. You think about updates for a new design, you apply those updates in your design and reanalyze your problem. Then you have a look at your updated design again and the results, and you proved that your updates were satisfying. If they weren't satisfying, you go back to the design and apply other updates. This is basically a never-ending story. Usually you do this in iterations, manually basically, so by hand. And if you are using OptiStruct, for example, the first thing you do is you create a finite element model. You define design variables, objective, and constraints. And then OptiStruct automatically evaluates the analysis results, defines updates for new improved designs, and finally returns to the analysis. Basically, you get really useful design suggestion, which you can take to CAD and finalize it. Just for explanation, design variables are values that can be changed in the model. For example, the thickness of a plate in a so-called free size optimization, or the element density threshold in a topology optimization. Furthermore, next to design variables, we have responses. These are values that can be measured from a model. For example, the normal strain. Then we have constraints. Constraints are limits on the responses which must be satisfied for a feasible design. For example, the normal strain mustn't be greater than 1.5%. In the end, we just have to define an objective. An objective is a single response of the model which is to be minimized or maximized. For example, we can minimize the mass, or we can minimize the compliance. So now let me tell you a few words about composite optimization. Basically, we define everything what you have seen before. We define design variables, we define responses, we define constraints and objective, also in a composite optimization. And what do we do in a composite optimization? We do composite tree size optimization and composite size optimization. The goal of composite tree size optimization is to find Bliche shapes, which are the most efficient for our load case. And then we have the composite site optimization. There we want to answer the question of how many plies of each ply shape are required to satisfy the strength or manufacturing engineering requirements. To answer those questions, I would like you to open HyperWorks now and follow my steps again. All right. For this optimization part, I prepared a model file for you. It's a .fem file, so please import this by using the File Manager, Files, Import Solverdeck, and the name of this file is head.fm. Just click on Reader Opti-Struct Import, and then this head structure. It's basically a beam with something like a head as cross-section. I will display the elements and okay, yeah. That's it so far, yeah. Let's have a look at the model browser. We only have one component. If I double-click on this component, we see that we have only a mesh array level, yeah. So no geometry, only a mesh. Then we have information about the number of elements and number of nodes. And that's basically it. So we have no material, no property, no load collectors, no load steps, no so nothing we have defined here. Since this is a composite optimization tutorial, I will go through all the important steps of composite definition again, but a bit faster than in the introduction video of this composite plate. The first thing we always checked was the element normal direction. We did it in the composite browser. You say you go to model and you go here to composite ribbon, and then this composite browser will open. I will just close this component browser, and now we are back in this composite browser. The element normal direction, we can check if we go right click here on the in this white field somewhere in the composite browser, say element normal, then this orientation review will open. I pick my elements here. I just want to pick my elements, okay. Then I say, okay, please color display, and I say apply so elements. I have to select them, okay. And then I click apply. And you see that this time, not all the elements are pointing in the same direction. I would like to have all element normals pointing out of this surface. So I close this window and go to element, say normals. And then I'm going to, I will be referred to this element normal panel. I say, okay, I'm changing to element here. Orientation should be element. Then I say color display. I say display. And then I'm just choosing one element, which is red here. I have to deselect those elements. Then one element, which is red. Then I'm going back to elements, choose all elements, and say adjust. And then every element is red colored. That means all normal vectors are pointing out now. This was the first thing we had to check. The second thing is that we have to define the material reference orientation. I click here return. Material reference orientation was done by right click here, say orient and material reference orientation. We have to select elements again. I choose all the elements here. Then scaling option, I leave all auto, and then X direction method instead of using a local coordinate system. Now I'm choosing a curve. And instead of, since we don't have any geometry in our model, I am switching to nodes. Click here in this node field, and by clicking one node here and by pressing Alt on my keyboard, I define a node path all to the end of this beam. This is here, then we have this over here and here and here. Okay, yeah. This, and if you click on apply now, and if you have a look here, you will see that our element, that our material reference orientation will now follow the curvature of this part. If you would have defined a local coordinate system, this wouldn't be the case. I hit cancel here because I'm done with the defining the material reference orientation, and now I can go straight over to the orthotrophic material generation. We did it here in the composite browser. We said create material. Automatically, a material card Mat8 is going to be created, and I can just rename my material to material carbon, for example. Then I type in my values. 203, 13. Then this should be 7, 9, 30. Then I'm defining this with 0.34. G12 should be 3790, and 2760. And density should be 1.555 e minus this one, yeah. And then I'm also going to define allowable strain or stresses. In this case, I want to define allowable strains. I say, okay, tension strain in fiber direction should be 0.08. Then compression is 0.006. So 0.6%, then we have here a value like this. Then here we have something like 0.006 again, and 0.006 again for S, yeah. What we have to do if we define strains here, by default, if you type in some values here, these are allowable stress values. If you want to have these as allowable strain values, you just go here to strn and type 1.0 inside here. That means that these values are now allowable stress value. I'm sorry, allowable strain values. Good, our material is defined now. And the next thing we have to do is to create plies. So first thing is we have to create ply shapes. And on afterwards we create plies, then we create a laminate. To create ply shapes, we said we just right click here in the composite browser, say create and shape. I name it again shape full because I want to have all my elements as one ply. For the free size optimization, I just go here to element and select my elements over here. Say, okay, we have 4920 elements now in this shape full. After defining the shape, I can create a ply. I just click on right click, create ply. I say, okay, I want the orientation of 0 degrees. I want the thickness of 1 degree. I want my material I created before. And I'm choosing my shape. This should be the full shape, yeah? That's good for this for now. Then I'm going to duplicate my ply 3 times in order to create 3 more plies. My prefix should be ply, and I want to create 3 more plies. And now we have to know what the free size optimization for composites actually does. We have to define plies with a specific ply orientation. Let's say we are defining now plies with 0 degrees, 90 degrees, 45 degrees, and minus 45 degrees. That means we are giving OptiStruct exactly these values, and we will get only applies with those angles back of the optimization. Like I said in the introduction, with composite field size optimization, we will get proposals for ply shapes, but these ply shapes will have then these orientations we are defining here. So if you want to have more than four orientations, you should define more than four plies. Okay, I'm changing just the colors to get a bit, to clean up my model a bit and to, just to clean up my model a bit. And this one here, yeah. Good, now we have four plies defined. I want to have different orientations, like I said, 90, 45 and minus 45. Material should be carbon for all of them, and all of them should have the shape full at the beginning, yeah. Just as a hint, I have a total laminate thickness of 4 millimeters now. This is just a value. This 4 millimeters I assumed. So basically, I did it like this. I modeled this part. Or I signed a steel material card for this part, applied the boundary conditions and the loads we will see later on this model, and just measured displacement. And then I manually changed the thickness of this structure here. And I came up with 4 millimeters because for steel material, the displacement, the overall displacement was in a good range. So if you have some structure you want to optimize and you don't know which values you should put in here, it's always a good idea to just model this with an isotropic material and just have a look at the displacements if they are way out of range. So I don't know, 10 millimeters, for example, for a small part is a value I would say it's way out of range. But if you have a big part and 10 millimeters, then you have to think about it already, if this is good or not good. Just as a hint, yeah. Now we are going to create our laminate just by right click, create laminate. This should be laminate one, and I just put my plies into this laminate. And the laminate properties, I am changing from laminate option total to smear. Smear is actually doing the following. This is with this option, we do not consider the stacking sequence of our laminate. So basically for optimization, for composite free size optimization, we are just interested in ply shapes. And so we are not interested in stacking sequence yet. This will follow later on. But for now, we just switch off these influences of the ply position in our laminate. And this is done by stack, by smear. After this, we have to create our property. It's just right click, create property. I say prop carbon. And this time I again choose this set 0.0. So basically I'm saying, okay, this is a structure from CAD, I got it. And I'm modeling my elements on the inner surface. And since my element normals are pointing out, my laminate will be stacked from ply one, what you would see here, to the outside, to ply four in this case, yeah. And this set zero option, it's now this is the reason I'm using it like this now. And I'm also saying, okay, I will fix my whole the whole end here will be fixed to a wall or something like this, and I only want the fixation here at this edge, and I will say okay, it's I will treat it as welded, and my welding seam is on the inside. Just as an example, yeah. Normally, of course, you might consider to weld it from both sides, or maybe only from the outer side because you can reach it better. But for now, I'm just saying, okay, I just want it there. That's the reason I'm also putting here set zero. Okay, that's it so far with the property. Then we have to assign this property to those elements here. This is done by right click assign. Then we want to assign prop carbon to elements, and I'm choosing all the elements here and clicking OK. Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, good. Then I will just have a quick look at my thickness if it was assigned. Okay, it was assigned. If I'm clicking here on plies and here on plies as well, I can see my different plies. Ply 1, ply 2, ply 3, ply 4. That's good. It was defined like I wanted it to be defined, yeah. Perfect. I can just switch this off and switch this off. Then I might want to see material reference. Then I'm going here again, and I see that my X direction of every element for my really material reference orientation is defined. That's perfect. And I switched it off by just clicking here on material references again. And okay, our part, laminate should be defined. And what we have to do now is that we want to fix all degrees of freedom at this edge here. So we create a load collector, create, not here in the model browser, we have to do it, right click create load collector. I say just BC 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, I give it a nice color, like maybe something like this. And now I'm going to analyze ribbon, go to this, not to display button. This was wrong. I just want to go to boundary condition constraints. I want to create. I want to create on nodes. I want to, this is just from before, from this metal plate. I want to constrain all six directions and node by path. Then I can just select three nodes here. And if I click on create, you see that the whole edge is now constrained in all directions. As I said, this is a classical boundary condition for a welded structure because everything is constrained in every direction. Perfect, yeah. Now I want to create a load here on this edge here. I would like to create a load depending on the local coordinate system down here. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to create a coordinate system here, sorry, and define my load depending on this local coordinate system. Okay, first thing we are going to do is we say okay, I'm going to create a temporary node here in this middle. To do that, I'm going to the geometry panel, say here create point nodes. I'm changing here to nodes, and then I'm just putting with drag and drop, I go from one side to the other side, middle mouse button to accept, and now I have created my node. To now define a local coordinate system, I have to define the origin, we have it here, then we have to define one axis and basically two axes then. I'm going to translate this node now in the direction of this edge here. To do that, I'm going to use this move tool. I say move, I don't want to move nodes. I want to move nodes, exactly. Then I'm going to press the shift button on my keyboard and move this move tool to this lower point here. And then I'm orientating by drag and drop the Z-axis to this point over here. So you can see that the move tool is now fixed to this edge, and this Z-axis of this move tool is lying on this edge. So if I say now X-axis, for example, and 5 millimeters, my node will be translated 5 millimeters in this local set coordinate. Yeah. With the mouse button to accept, and then I just create again a new node, and I'm going from here to here. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Then I have this node now. Select. Now I have two nodes, and now I can create my coordinate system. To create a coordinate system, we just go again to model systems over here. We want to create a rectangular local coordinate system. We want the origin here. I want my y-axis here, and I want my y-z plane here. And if you click create, your local coordinate system is created, and you can see that your y-axis is pointing to in this direction, z-axis is pointing in this direction. I click on return, and I'm going to delete those two nodes. And then I'm just giving the system collector another color. Let's say something like this, and I call it system load. Okay, yeah. If I want now to define a load, I can go to, I have to create a load collector first. Let's say here in the model browser, create load collector. I call it load force. First, yeah. Then I'm going to the analyze ribbon again, go here on apply forces. Then here I have the possibility to create forces on nodes. This is exactly what we want to do. But we don't want to apply a magnitude. We don't want to apply the force based on the global system. We want to apply it based on the local system. I just select my local system, and we don't want to apply a magnitude. We want to apply a load depending on an equation. And this equation should be based on the z-axis, and the equation should be 0.25 times absolute of 2 times y. And what does this do? We have this coordinate system now. So basically, if we are taking this point, this equation takes the y value depending on this coordinate system and multiplies it by 2, takes the absolute value of this and divides it by 4 again. Now we just have to define our node path where we want to apply these forces and hit create. And as you can see, you get a non-equal force over the length. And yeah, basically, you get the same force here, you get it here. Yeah. And here, where the y value is not changing, you get everywhere 6.25. I hit return. So my load is now defined. And then I'm able to define my load step already. I just go here to this view and click here create load step. And I'm going to define my step one. Yeah. I again want to do linear static. My boundary condition or single point constraint is this one here. My load in this case is this one over here, load force. And then I just go to the output and I want to request cease train. Again, with corner data, cease stress with corner data. I want to have displacement. Last but not least, I want to have I want to request C failure, and this is fine. And since I'm defining or requesting C failure, I have to go back to my composite browser, go here to property carbon, and here you can see the failure theory. And if you open it, you can see that you have the failure hill, I think, Saihu, then you have the maximum strain, which I was talking about. And I'm going to choose maximum strain. And now we are ready for analyzing. My recommendation is that you analyze every part you want to optimize before you optimize it. The reason for this is just to check if you have displacements up in the sky, or if something is unlogical, if you have defined everything right as it should be. To run the analyzers, I just go to run here, say, okay, I save it somewhere, say run option analyzers and hit obdestruct. This might take a few seconds now. And if we have done everything right, this will be again, of course. Fine, I'm opening Hyper-V already on the second screen, and have a look at my displacements then. Good, this is completed, this is fine. I close this, we don't have any warning or error messages. So I'm going here to Hyper-V and open my model file, or my result file. I'm going to open it. It's not here, it's here in head and head 3D. Then I just do this one time and this to have this back. And now I can see if I go to displacement and say, okay, please show me the magnitude, that we have a displacement of around 2.15 millimeters here. Yeah, this is for me a logical value, because if you think about this, this part is quite long, and if you press here with a force, this really can be that you deform it 2 millimeters. Yeah. I just say here, I just want to check something else. I click apply and okay. I'm showing my mesh and then I'm going here to result type and say, I want to have composite failure index. I'm saying here failure index and I click on apply. And then you can see that my composite failure index is way below one. So these first by failure criteria work like this. If you have a value between 0 and 1, your plies meet the first ply failure index. If the value is above one, they don't meet this failure index. But be careful, this is just the first ply failure index. Even if you get a value below one, your part still can break. It's just a good orientation you can follow to also request failure index, yeah? Indexes, yes. If you go here to composite failure, you can also go to every ply and you click on apply and you can see the failure indexes for every ply on its own. That's cool, yeah? So I will just close this post-processing window because everything should or everything is working fine. I'm going back to Hypermesh and start with the optimization. Good, I make this window again one. Okay, and close this here. Then, okay, yeah. Optimization, like we have seen yesterday already, we go here on optimize, and here on this optimize ribbon, we can go to the optimization browser. As said in the introduction, we want to do a composite tree size optimization. That means we can click here on tree size. Here we can define a name for our tree size optimization and configuration is tree size, of course. Entity type, it's not a p-shell, it's a stack now. And if we choose a laminate here in the list of laminate, we will see that this window here is getting quite big. These are all manufacturing constraints we can enter here. As I said in the topology tutorial at the beginning, it's better to start with as less as possible constraints. So I usually start with min dim and I type in 10 millimeters here. The average element size of what we have here in this model is 5 millimeters. So min dim is forcing, or Optistruct is forcing the, or min dim is forcing Optistruct to create ply shapes with at least a width of 10 millimeters, so at least two elements. The next thing I want to do is this balance option. We have defined four plies with four different angles. By default, Optistruct is creating four design proposals or four different ply shapes for each angle. And since we defined four plies, we would get 16 different ply shapes after or during composite tree size optimization. We can group specific angles together so that we reduce the number of created ply shapes. For example, we can group 45 degrees and minus 45 degrees, and so we would reduce the number of ply shapes from the number of different ply shapes from 16 to 12. I click close and then my design variable, which defines values that can be changed in the model. Yeah, in our case, that would be the ply shape. The next thing we have to create are responses that are values that can be measured from a model. In our case, I want, or usually at the beginning, I start with a volume fracture response and the compliance response. Volume fracture is I want to constrain, basically later on in the next step, I want to tell Optistruct, okay, hey, Optistruct, I have here a part with a specific volume. Please only use, for example, 30% of this volume to create a proposal design. And this is what I'm going to do with this volume fracture here, what I'm defining now. Volume frac. And this is a volume fracture. You just go here, volume fracture for response type, and that's okay, yeah? The second response I'm using for my objective because in every optimization, we have to define exactly one objective. This is the overall goal of the optimization. In this case, I always start with compliance. The compliance is the inverse of the stiffness. So if I say, okay, please minimize my compliance, I tell this as objective. That means that the stiffness of my overall part will be maximized. So we have basically a We tell Optistruct, okay, please take only 30% of this volume here and make the stiffest structure as possible out of it. This is done with those two responses here, yeah? Constraints, we said, okay, we want to create a constraint. This should be our volume fracture, volume frac. And we define a response here. We said this is response volume frac. Then we say we want to have an upper bound, and I will set it to 30%. Yeah, that's good. And fine. You can see here in the optimization browser that you have now a constraint. You have one design variable, and you have two responses. Now we have to define the objective. We just click here on objective, say, okay, objective is min compliance, so maximize the stiffness. Objective type is minimized, and we say, okay, please minimize the compliance. And we have to select our load step, and I say, okay, and I say close. So basically, everything is defined now, and in order to create a hypermesh database while doing optimization, so that we can load the design proposal into hypermesh again, we can ask Optistruct to create us a .fem file, so a solverdeck file. This is done by clicking here on Analyze. And if you go here on Analyze on this opening, you will be, no, not on this, on this play button, sorry. You will be directed to this Analyze panel again. Yeah, now it's opening. And you hit Return, and here on Analyzes, you can go to Control Card. And here you go on next until you see output. It's here, yeah. And I want an output from basically this output should be free size to size. I see it here, free size to size. And this means, okay, we are doing a free size optimization and we want an input file for our size optimization. I hit return and return. Then I'm going to my optimize ribbon and click here on play by on optimize. I'm saving my component or my optimization under new folder. This is head opt. I save it. Then I'm changing from run options analysis to optimization and hit Optistruct. So after a few seconds or minutes, we get the answer that the optimization has converged and we got a feasible design that all constraints were satisfied. You can see here that it took Optistruct 7 iterations to find an optimal solution, and I'm going to close this window now and save my model. Then I will open a new Hypermesh database by just clicking here new and import the result of this composite free size optimization. Go here file import solverdeck. I'm going to go here, this head sizing 7. 7 stands for iteration 7.fem. And I open it, I say reader Optistruct, and the rest should be left as it is. And then I just can rotate it a bit and go to my composite browser and have a look at my laminate. As mentioned before, Optistruct is during composite free size optimization, Optistruct is creating four individual glide shapes for every ply orientation. You can have a look at those ply shapes by clicking here on this ply and click Q on your keyboard. And then it's the same as if you would click right click and review. And if you click through the plies, you can see all your ply shapes. You can see then if you go to ply 3200, so 3 stands for orientation 3, ply, and then this 2 stands for ply shape number 2. And if you compare this with the one ply 4200, you will see that it's the same. This is because of the balance option we have used in the manufacturing constraints by defining the design variable at the beginning of optimization. You can, of course, go and you can leave this tool, this review. And if you want, for example, now I go to this ply 1300 and say, okay, I go to shapes and say 1300, and I go to this elements, and then you can see the elements you have here in your ply shape. If you want to add or remove elements, you can do it inside here. This is not a problem. And yeah, this is basically what you can do here. What's nice is that we already have ply shapes now, and the next step is the size optimization. So in the size optimization, the ply shapes wouldn't be changed anymore. That means that we already can, or in the size optimization, it's only this the number of plies per ply shapes, which is important then. But that means that we already can, for example, take one shape here. Let's say we want to take shape 1300, say isolate here. And okay, maybe not this one, because there we have this region in front of here. This is one of the shapes I would maybe update a bit by hand. I would just take here a bit more elements to define this shape. Just wanted to show something else. If I go here to isolate, maybe the 3500. I'm just looking for a ply shape. Okay, yeah, this is nice. You see, we have this ply shape 3200. Basically, we have a big shape here, and we have two, or basically one side shape here, which is going all the way here. You might want to create a geometry data out of it, and I just want to show it to you. I'm opening panels and go here to geometry. And if you go here to surfaces, you can create here from FE. So if you select those elements right over here and click create, you will see that hypermesh is creating a surface for you out of these elements which are saved in ply 3200. If you now go to the composite browser, for example, double click here on the components browser, and hide the mesh, you can see that you have created geometries here, so a surface. This surface you can export you can export a step file, for example, and you can open it with CAD software. And in this CAD software, you can, for example, change these structures here, that you don't have the sharp edges there, that you have a nice radius, for example, here. And yeah, then you can go back to HyperWorks, import your newly created shape, and start the definition of laminate again. For now, I just wanted to show you how to create surfaces out of mesh data. This is fine for now. And yeah, the last step is now the composite size optimization. Okay, now please go to the composite browser and have a look at the ply thicknesses here of each single ply. Since the purpose of the composite free size optimization is the finding efficient ply shapes, we didn't care a lot about ply thicknesses. But for now, as you know, nobody has those ply thicknesses available at all. So we are going to change a few values. To do that, I'm going to the optimization view and go here to design variables. And you can see that now 16 new design variables were created, each for the thickness of each of the ply shapes. If you click here on FSTOSZ, so free size to size, then you can see that you have an initial value. This is basically the ply thickness, the current ply thickness, a lower bound and an upper bound. And we now have to change the upper bound to a number which is actually manufacturable, or which is like just a logical number, so not a number with I don't know how many digits, just one digit, and this should be enough. This has to be done for every single ply. I'd say this is now 0.3, for example. This upper bound should be greater than the initial value, and now the task would be to go through all the values here. Yeah, here for example 0.5 then. And then the next one, we also go 0.3, for example, and so on. Then this one here is, for example, 0.1. I just choose a way larger than the initial value. Then in 5, we have again 0.2, or also 0.1. 0.1, yeah, and in 6 we have, let's say, 0.2, and 7 we have 0.7, yeah, then in 8 this also should be greater, so 0.1, then also 0.1, then this is 0.2, then in 11 we have 0.7, 0.7, then 12 is 0.1, 0.1, 13 is 0.1, this is 0.2, and this is 0.7. So now we changed all the upper bounds to a logical value, or to a value which is which doesn't have many digits. So basically an upper bound which can basically be manufactured. Manufactured is a good point for the next step. We have to define manufacturing constraints on our plies now. This is done here in the composite browser. And if you click on one of the plies and go to the entity browser, for example, you can see here that you have the manufacturing thickness for plies. Yeah, you can change these values to to numbers you have available. For example, in your workshop, let's say you have ply thicknesses of 0.1, 0.3 millimeters, and 0.5 millimeters. At home, you can just change the manufacturing thickness to those ply thicknesses. For example, I just can mark all plies and just say, okay, I have a ply thickness, I only have plies with a thickness of 0.25 millimeters in my workshop, and then this is taking into consideration. And now if we run the size optimization, OptiStruct will find the optimal number of every ply shape we have to create to satisfy all our constraints. Before I'm going to do my size optimization, I'm going back to my optimization browser and define new responses, new constraints, and new objectives. I'm going to delete my old responses, say delete entities. We don't have any constraints, and our design variables are the ones we treated before. I want to have a new response. This should be response static displacement. Okay, here I'm looking for static displacement. We have to define two nodes which shouldn't move more than a specific value. Then I'm going to say, okay, they shouldn't move in direction 3 of this coordinate system. So I'm just choosing this coordinate system here and say close. Okay. Then I'm going to create a second response. This should be response mass, because I want to reduce my overall mass. This should be my objective. Constraint, as I said, this should be static displacement. Response is static displacement. The response load steps is step 1. And I want an upper bound of 2.5 millimeters. Yeah, I say close. And now I have to define my objective. This should be objective mass. I want to reduce my overall mass. And minimize response ID is mass. I click OK, close, and in order to generate a hypermesh model again, or a .fem model, I'm going to analyze this again, control cards to output, and I'm changing from free size to size to size to shuffle. Return, and OptiStruct, and then I hit OptiStruct. So after a few seconds and 3 iterations, we get the message that the optimization has converged. We got a feasible design, which means that all constraints were satisfied. I close this, then I save this database. This was size to shuffle, size to shuffle. And I'm opening a new HyperWorks database, import my newly created solver deck. This should be no size to shuffle. This should be head shuffling.3.fem import. And if we go now to our standard view here, and go to the composite browser and go to laminates, you see that now all laminates have a thickness of 0.25 millimeters. And you see that, for example, of that we have now how many plies? It's we have 17 plies, 17 shapes. And if you want to see the shapes, you will just click on review orientation or the review, and then you go through the shapes. And of course, those shapes didn't change. And you just can click through the plies, yeah. So basically now we have the number of plies we need for this load case here with all the constraints we have defined. You see that Now it's proposing us 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 plies in zero direction, 1, 2, 3, 4 plies in 90 degrees, in 45 degrees, and 4 in minus 45 degrees. Usually you would go through the plies now and sort them in your laminate so that the bigger plies, so the full ply shapes basically, are at the outer sides of this part, and the smaller ply shapes like these ones here, for example, if you hit Q, these should be somewhere in the middle of your laminate. If you think of it, if you apply loads on your structure and your laminate is deforming a bit, it could be that you directly get delamination if those little plies are at the outside of your structure. Furthermore, you could think about adding several more plies to the structure just to protect the main structure. Usually you can create new ply shapes and say, okay, I want on my outer skin, I want plus or minus 45 degrees. And this you can also do here in this laminate. So I hope that I was able to explain you a lot. I hope that you learned a lot. I know this topic is quite, I know that this topic is quite difficult, but just give it the time. You will come into this topic of finite elements, of simulation, of optimization, of composites. Just give it a few days, weeks, months, and then you will be able to define to design breathtaking structures. Thank you very much for listening to me. It was a pleasure for me to be part of this Altair webinar series. If you have any questions, just ask them. We are happy to answer them. Thank you.